Lovin. This is Kevin, and this is take two of episode number 65. Something happened with the file on the first one, and it most of it disappeared, so we're taking it from the top. Hopefully this one will be even better than the last one that no one will ever hear. So I want to talk today about the idea of childlike wonder and freeing your mind. And so I have a few clips to play, and those will be coming up in just a minute. Shots of Awe, Zan Parian, and School of Life. So we'll get to that in just a sec. The last episode was with Danny Flood, part two of that. I also had a technical issue there, and the first upload of it, the file was blank. If anybody tried to download it, I fixed it about 12 hours later. Danny himself emailed me, and somebody else emailed me, and said, yeah, it's not. There's nothing there. So that happens from time to time, but the episode is up if you didn't get a chance to listen to that and you wanted to hear part two. It was a great chat. We had a really fun chat, and I really admire Danny and what he's doing in his traveling and his business and his book and everything. So check that out. That is episode number 64 if you haven't got a chance. So this episode, I wanted to touch on this idea of childlike wonder and kind of approaching life as if everything is new. And that's so hard to do because most people are in sort of a routine and everything just becomes monotonous. Even if you're trying to mix it up a lot, it sometimes can become just same thing every day. And then time goes by really fast when you have that sort of day in and day out, same thing over and over. My example of when I felt this the most of this, like everything is brand new and time is going super slow in a good way, and just feeling like there's just one adventure and one new thing after another. The first time that happened to me really was in college, the freshman year in college, just going off. You know, I grew up, I feel like I was fairly sheltered growing up. I did not feel like I really got exposed to a lot of things in the world, and I kind of had this narrow view of things. And so when I got to college, I started meeting people from all over the place, and I was exposed to like just different ways of thinking about things, different types of music, different, you know, all sorts of different people with different motivations. And that just really opened up my world quite a bit. And I'm not saying that college is for everyone, but that in that time in my life, I think it was great. I went to a school that was about 7 hours from where I grew up. And so there was no chance of me escaping and going home on a weekend to do laundry or any of that. I had to just suck it up and be on my own. Even though I was getting most things paid for, it was quite a shock of independence and freedom that in some ways I did not handle very well. I did not know how to budget my time. Growing up, I had a schedule where I had to be in bed. I think it was like 10 o'clock every night. And so I really stayed up late. And then as soon as I got out, had that freedom, I started just staying up super late every night. Sort of just an automatic, it was just an automatic kind of rebellion. It wasn't even like I thought it through. I just found myself, first I was up till like 1, and then I was up till 2, then I was up till 3, and then 4. And pretty soon it was just like, I was up all night, most nights of the week, and I was starting to miss classes and, you know, things like that. But the bottom line is when I got there, it was just a lot of freedom and a lot of looking at everything in a new way. And the other time that I had this was, and I've mentioned this quite a few times on this podcast, but when I went to Southeast Asia a couple of years ago, and I just went, had a one-way ticket and just had no agenda, that was something where every place I went was brand new. And I was just absorbing like just a totally different culture. I was staying in different places. Every few days, I would move on to a new place. And nothing was set. I had no agenda. So it was just time was going by really slowly. I was there for 2.5 months. It felt like about 6 months. You know, when I look back at the trip, I was like, wow, I did so many things in that span of time. And it was like I'd been traveling a lot longer. And that's just something that happens with, you know, the more you can travel, the more that happens. So today I wanted to, I have a few clips that I want to get to. And the first one is from Shots of Awe. That's a YouTube channel. And I'll play that and I'll be back in just a sec.
All right, so the idea is to believe in a more brilliant world. Of course, this requires a childlike state of wonder. As Alan Harrington wrote in The Immortalist, we must all remain uncompromising child voyagers and retain a child's eye view of what might be. What happens with adults is that we become jaded, you know, the been there's and done that's of the adult mind. It's a form of laziness. It's a form of dispensing with the here and now and jumping to the conclusions. It's a sort of impatience with lived life that we need to transcend. We need to re-engage with the senses. We need to awaken the mind's attention from the lethargy of custom and the film of familiarity and redirecting it instead to the wonders of existence. You know, absolute unmixed attention is a form of prayer. Looking begins with love. Love begins with looking. This is the eye of the child. This is the mind of the child. We're all born artists. We're all born ecstasy seekers. And then it just kind of gets like pummeled out of us. It gets like stripped away by banality. What is banality and boredom if not defenses the educated mind employs against experience so that it's not continually exhaustingly astonished, as Michael Pollan wrote in The Botany of Desire. And it's true, it would be astonishing to be open to it all at any given time. Just read James Joyce. But we must nonetheless strive to re-enter these spaces, because these are the only spaces that have ever led to visions that have transformed the world. And that, my friends, is that.
And that's Jason Silva's YouTube channel, Shots of Awe, and I'll have a link to that in the show notes. But that's one that I tend to review. I tend to watch you know, every so often just to get some inspiration. I think it's just a great message because we all have that child within us. And that is, it's so important to kind of acknowledge that and to really look at the world as new, as everything is kind of new, because that's how we were when we were kids. Everything was brand new. And it's, you know, it's hard to do when you have a routine, when you have things that you do all over and over, but you can, there's so many ways you can make that, make your life more like being a little kid with travel especially, but even, you know, so many things you can take on if you're not traveling. If you're just in one place, you can learn something new or just to explore different areas around where you live or, you know, whatever it is. The next one is from, it's an interview with Zan Parian, and it's on a podcast. And I was watching this, I had read some articles on polyphasic sleep, and I think it's a really interesting concept. It's basically where you don't sleep all at once. You basically break up your sleep. So the idea is that people think that back before electricity, that people just fell asleep like right after it got dark, and then they'd get up out of bed when it got light. But that's actually not true. What they did is they did likely go to sleep sometime after it got dark, but they would sleep for maybe 4, 5, 6 hours and then get up and then, you know, maybe go to bed at like 7 and wake up at like midnight. And then they would do things. So they would actually, you know, maybe do cleaning, have sex, you know, like do all kinds of things. And then they go back to bed and then wake up, you know, maybe go back to bed at like 3 and wake up when it gets light. So breaking it up like that is not, it's not a bad thing. And it could actually be more natural for humans, is what some of these articles are saying. I did this by total accident. I went to bed one night at 11, woke up at 2, and I was wide awake. I don't know why. I think I like had too much coffee or something that day. And I felt like, okay, what am I going to do? I thought about working, but I didn't really feel like working. So I started watching some videos, just some YouTube videos, some interesting topics. And there's a guy, Zan Parian, who I have followed quite a bit. I used to really read a lot of his stuff. I read his book last year. He talks a lot about relationships and dating, but he's also an adventurer. He's a guy that quit his job. He had a really high-paying job up in, I think he was in Vancouver, and he just quit his job and sold all his stuff and just hit the road and didn't really have a plan. And so it's pretty interesting, like what he's been able to do. And I love his philosophy and kind of the way he goes about life. So here's the clip, and play this, and then I'll be back in just a sec.
So sell everything that you own and hit the road. Where did that come from?
Well, this is me. Like I'll tell you very quickly, because people have heard my story before. I grew up in northern Canada in the forest. Like my formal education ended at 13 years old. And I was living in the forest with, you know, no running water, electricity, this kind of thing, with moccasins on my feet and an axe in my hands and running through the trees. And I literally had nothing. I remember living in a cabin by myself when I was 13, 14 years old with grass on the roof, a tiny, small little, you know, cabin and a log cabin. And I would sit there and all I had was a handmade bed with a comforter on it and a little desk and a kerosene lamp. And I sat there and I would write in a journal when I was a kid, when I was those age. And the simplicity of that, I think, has never left me. My short stories, I ran away from that with no education. I somehow ingratiated myself into the corporate world, and I became very high placed in an international company. And I was in charge of the commodities for the company. I was in charge of the IT because I'm a computer nerd. Self-taught. I learned all this myself. Mm. And I was very high placed in an international company at one point. But, you know, I used to sit in the boardroom and look around at, you know, the things we're tackling that day for 12 hours. And I would think, I'm only here for a paycheck. Just that's the only reason I'm here, so I can have the illusion of a free life and fun on the weekend. And so I thought about it for many years. I was in the corporate world for a long time. But the real me and the real authentic me is that kid sneaking through the forest. That's me. And so I sold my apartment. I gave all my possessions away. Didn't sell any of that. I called up all my ex-girlfriends and said, come get whatever you want from my place. I gave it all away and I reduced myself down to a carry-on bag and only that. And for the last 10 years, I've been basically a carry-on only, and I've lived all over the world and traveling the whole time. And I feel it's authentic to me. I'm not saying everybody should quit their job and go cast off and, like, you know, sail the world. But for me, that is my authenticity. I'm this kid sneaking through the forest with, you know, thinking about, I don't know. And I feel like I've gone back to that, or I'm heading back to that simplicity of that. And it's more, it is who I am. It is the fundamental nature of who I am.
So that was a podcast. That was a clip from a podcast from Steve Maeda, and I'll have the link in the show notes as well to the YouTube video. So yeah, I really just love what he said about being a child running through the forest and it kind of going back to that. And what he's saying is he's going back to that now, and that's so, it's just so awesome. I mean, for me, it reminds me of being a little kid and running around. We had this canyon in the backyard, and it just was like wide open, and it just seemed so massive and just unlimited possibilities. And that's what I think he's getting at, is bringing those unlimited, limitless possibilities into your life all the time. And it just helps to really make it a fulfilling life. And the next clip that I have is from a YouTube channel called School of Life. And actually, I had never seen this before, but somebody posted it on Facebook. This one is more about how to find fulfilling work. So I'm going to go ahead and play this, and then I'll talk to you on the other side.
The idea that work might be fulfilling rather than just painfully necessary is a strikingly recent invention. Open Dr. Johnson's celebrated dictionary, published in 1755, and the word fulfillment doesn't even appear. Nowadays, in a prosperous world, we don't only expect to obtain money through our labour, we also, to a greater or lesser extent, expect to find meaning and satisfaction. It's a big ask, and helps to explain why so many of us have career crises, often on a Sunday evening, as the sun begins to set. To help us on the quest for fulfilling work, here are six useful ideas. Firstly, accept that being confused about careers is perfectly normal. In the pre-industrial world, there were at most some 2,000 different trades out there. Nowadays, there are estimated to be 500,000 different options. The result? We can become so anxious about making the wrong choice, we end up making no choice at all. Psychologists call this the paradox of choice, paralysis stemming from too many options. We should acknowledge that confusion is natural and fear entirely normal, but let neither of these scupper our chances forever. Secondly, know yourself. It's the oldest philosophical recommendation and is of particular relevance to careers. For 99% of us, knowing what we want to do doesn't arise spontaneously, like, for example, knowing what to eat. Most of us don't have a calling. We don't hear a commanding, godlike voice directing us to accountancy or packaging and distribution. That isn't to say we don't have tastes or inclinations. We just don't know them clearly enough. which is a perilous position to be in, as not having a plan quickly puts us at the mercy of those who do have one. We only catch glimpses, little hints of our tastes. So what we have to do is learn to pick up on their faint sounds. Start by parking any concerns for money for a time. Financial panic too often kills all dialogue with the more authentic, passionate sides of one's nature. Write down, without being too logical or analytical about it, everything you've ever enjoyed doing or making, which might include building a treehouse or sorting out the winter clothes. The weirder and more offbeat the list, the better. In the long and confused tangle that follows, there will somewhere be the shape of an ideal future working self. But it'll be very messed up and in need of being analysed thoroughly. That's where philosophy comes in. Philosophy is the art of clearing up and demanding logic of our first thoughts. Thirdly, think a lot. If it might take a couple of days, even a week, to choose a new car, it could fairly take a year or more of sustained daily reflection to start to identify a career that fits. We tend to feel guilty about this, imagining we're being self-indulgent. Far from it. We may need to empty every weekend for months to sort out the biggest conundrum of our lives. To make sure we don't continue to spend the rest of our lives trapped in a job unwittingly chosen for us by our unknowing 16-year-old selves, we need to be properly generous about the amount of time we'll need to give this. Fourthly, try something. It's tempting to imagine we'll be able to work out the shape of the workplace and of our own characters simply through a pure process of reflection. But we need data, and we can only understand ourselves and others by colliding with the real world, in the process getting to know both it and our own natures. We need to take small, non-irrevocable steps to gather information, for example by shadowing, interning or volunteering. We mustn't think we always have to resign on Monday. We can investigate our futures through branching projects on the side of existing jobs. 5. Reflect on what makes people unhappy. Every successful business is at heart an attempt to solve someone else's problem. The bigger and more urgent the problem, the greater the opportunity. To flex your entrepreneurial muscles, consider an average day and everything in it that might make someone unhappy, from losing the house keys to finding the food a little greasy to arguing yet again with their spouse. Each of these is a business opportunity waiting to be exploited. It's a chance for us to serve, which is what work really is. It's easy to imagine that everything's been done and tried. Nonsense. We're unhappy enough for capitalism to have many more centuries of invention and creativity to it. 6. Be confident. So many bad self-help books are about confidence. It can be tempting to dismiss the whole topic as nonsense. But in a peculiar and rather humbling way, it truly does seem as if the difference between success and failure is sometimes nothing less than the courage to give it a go. The ability to imagine oneself into a role, to surmise one doesn't need to ask anyone for permission. That many of the top positions simply belong to those who dare to boldly ask for them. A lack of confidence is at heart a misunderstanding of the way the world works. It's an internalized feudalism, which imagines that only certain people, but not oneself, have the right, preordained, to get certain things. It isn't true. As we know, a lot more is possible than we might think at our moments of timidity and doubt. That's the start of the path towards a job we won't regret on our deathbeds, which should always be the ultimate criterion.
There was so much packed into that little five-minute clip that I really thought it was helpful, quite helpful. I liked that he talked about lists, like writing lists. I think you cannot do enough of that. I tend to think a lot better, clear up my thoughts if I can write lists. And it can be completely outrageous. Like the example was building a treehouse. You just write down all these things and then you come up with ideas. And I'm starting to do the James Altucher recommendation of doing 10 ideas a day, writing down 10 ideas a day. And I have a book that James Altucher's wife, Claudia, wrote. And it basically gives you every day, each chapter is an idea of that you can write a list of 10 things. And it's really cool. So I'll put the link to that book in the show notes. Anyway, the list is great. Writing things down is really awesome, an awesome way to, and he says, get to know yourself. That's a great way to get to know yourself too. Think a lot. That's another one that I think people don't do enough of. It's kind of taking constant action is not the way to go because you don't really get to know what it is that you're after. I like the next point that he was making about having confidence was, you know, I took it as this idea of fake it till you make it. There are no experts out there. Because if you know a little more than everyone else, then you're an expert. So the idea that you have to have years of school or spend 10,000 hours or whatever to teach something doesn't really add up. So I like the idea of fake it till you make it. Just put yourself out there as the expert and see what happens. I mean, what's the worst case? I mean, it depends on what you're doing. But like when I started my online business, Try Swim Coach, I was nobody. I didn't have, I had a swimming background. That's why I got into the niche that I did. But I didn't have a name. I wasn't connected to any Olympians. I hadn't coached anyone. I barely even coached, really. And I was putting myself out there as an expert coach. And so, but I'd read books. I've been swimming myself for years. I know a lot. That's how I presented myself as an expert. And then I wrote a lot of articles and got them out there and had a website. So you sort of build credibility by just doing things, just putting yourself out there, putting your knowledge out there. So anyway, I also wanted to mention that, you know, sometimes people ask me about different various niches, like, oh, what do you think about this niche? What do you think about that niche? I think most of them are pretty good. I mean, there's some stuff that's not going to work. If you want to make like a living, you want to make money at it or a good amount of money, there's some things that aren't going to work. But there are so many niches out there that you could do, that you could get into. And if you know some people that are passionate about that, there's probably a lot more. So I say just go for it. So anyway, I hope this podcast was inspirational for you. And next week I'm going to be off to Mexico with my girlfriend, and we're going to go check out some ruins, some Mayan ruins, and that should be really interesting. So Palenque, we're going to see Palenque, and then we're going to go up to Mexico City for a couple days, and then head up to San Miguel de Allende, which is north of Mexico City. And it's supposed to be beautiful, and then that's it. So like a 9-day trip. I'll be back. Hopefully I'll get a podcast in from Mexico and get my thoughts down on what's going on there. And I really appreciate the emails I've been getting. A few people have updated me on their travels and their progress with their businesses, and that's awesome. I just love those emails. So if you are so inclined, if you want to give me an update on what you're up to, that would be, I'd love to hear from you. Kevin@freedomlovin.com. Otherwise, yeah, if you enjoy this, please give us a rating and review on iTunes. And I'll be back soon with another guest and some more freedom building ideas. So take care, go out there and build some freedom, and we'll talk to you soon. And today's music is a classic Black Sabbath live, Into the Void. Enjoy, rock on, and we'll talk to you soon.